Hello and happy, well, Friday for me, whatever the day of the week this ends up going live for you. I'm going to talk about how I bin used GPUs that I buy. So right now in March of 2023, a lot of the graphics cards I'm buying are previously used for mining from miners. And although historically miners take pretty good care of their cards to avoid things like fan failures and needing to repad and repaste due to the cost, sometimes there's issues, and of course there are good and bad cards as far as bin is concerned. So I just bought four 3070s and two A2000s, and I'm going to show you my process for how I grade or bin these cards when I get them. So the first step is ideally socket all of the cards you have that are of the same variety, and then get them booted into your mining OS of choice. Doesn't really matter if it's MMPOS, SMOS, Hive, Windows, whatever. We're just going to be overclocking on a couple different algorithms to kind of get a sense of how the efficiency goes and how the cores and memory perform. Okay, they're booted up. I have everything updated. Now the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to launch a core-based algorithm, Flux. It does use a little bit of memory, but it's largely core. So I'm going to lock the memory at 5000 and put the core at 1410. The next updates will be done in the actual dashboard on Hive OS. If you're doing this on Windows, you would just be essentially running your Flux Mini Z with the arguments in your GUI launcher. So right off the bat, we can see that there is a clear delineation between the two cards. GPU 0 has a much better core. Same wattage, lower hash rate on card 1. So now I'm going to up the offset and see if that gets even more pronounced. But when you up the offset, you do have to come up here and restart the miner, or come up here and restart your rig. However, when we start undervolting the core, we can see that this has completely flip-flopped, and GPU 1, which is this card, actually is better. So these cards are hard limited on how much power they can draw because they don't have any supplemental PCIe, and 35.68 is actually a very good number for an A2000. So I'm going to rate the core on this card as an A, and I'm going to rate the core on this card as a B. And I usually keep a little C and an M on the plate just so I can keep better tabs of what's what, and I use a system of one dot for A, two dots for B, and then three dots for C, four for D. But I tend to try to get rid of the D cards. All right, we've tested the core. Now let's move on to a memory hard algorithm. I'm going to be using Ethereum Classic for this, and I've put in some base overclocks that I know are pretty decent as a starting point that will run on any A2000. I've got 1200 core, and I've got 2600 memory, and eventually I'm gonna be cranking this up, hopefully all the way to about 4000, but I'm gonna be watching the hash rates as I do that to see when they start tapering off and what the overall performance looks like at that particular power threshold. So I'm expecting GPU 1 to be better overall, just because the GPU is binned better and the core can take less power and give more of that power budget over to the memory. There's just one pool of power in a GPU and it has to be split between the memory and the actual core. So typically, the lower power of the memory, like a Samsung memory versus a Hynix, you'll have a little bit more power budget left for the core, and if you have a better binned core, you have more power budget left for your memory. It's confusing, but that does seem to add up. So let's refresh this. They're both doing 40.0, so that's a great sign that they are working correctly. So I'm going to start, after a couple of minutes, raising the memory by 200 megahertz each, and in Windows that would be 100. Each, and I would start at 1300 in Afterburner or 2600 in anything Linux-based. Another easy thing to look at to kind of prove that we do indeed have a better core in GPU 1 is you can see that although we have these set at 1200, they will only run as fast as the power limit will support, and the fact that we have a slightly higher core clock on GPU 1 means that more of that same pool of power is able to go to the GPU die itself. Right now we're not seeing any difference because we are very, very much still memory frequency bound, but as we start going up in frequency, we should see that deviate. All right, so we're up to 3600, or that would be, what, 1800 in Windows, and now we're actually starting to see that deviation. Before, we really weren't. but now we can see card one is pulling ahead because we have a little bit higher core clock with the same memory clock. So we'll see if that continues on the same trajectory, but card zero might be happiest at 3400 mem. It's a toss-up, but I would say that they're both pretty good, and card one is slightly better. So you can see I have just a very slightly higher memory clock on this card, and they're both running the same core clock consistently. This card is getting more accepted shares, so the core has a lot to do with it, but I'm still going to grade the memory on both of these as A. So that's kind of my process there, but let me shove some 3070s in here, and we'll go from there. You can see these cards are still both pretty good. The core really doesn't affect it as much just because it's running down clock so much, and the A2000 is a really low power GPU. We'll see more of a difference with the 3070s. This is something you will only ever see with 3070s. This is a 650 watt power supply, and it's in fan stop, and they're mining, and every one of these cards is in fan stop, and they're mining. However, look already. I'm going to refresh this, but look at the power consumption with the same OCs. It looks like our Gigabyte is a hunk of junk, and it looks like both the FTWs, well, one of the FTWs, zero, the close one, is actually pretty darn good at 110 watts. The other one's pretty good at 113, and then the XC3 at 116 is decent. So we have one really excellent 3070, which is the FTW3 closest to me. Looks like the Gigabyte's the first to throw in the towel and kick on the fans. And we are at 562 watts at the wall on 110 volts, like I said, through a 650 gold ATX power supply. I love getting used GPUs, man. It like gamifies mining. What we're seeing right now, and I think this is gonna become more present, well, maybe not. This is hopping around a little bit, but this is where you see the primary difference, in my opinion, between an XC3 EVGA and an FTW. They definitely bend the memory chips, and I believe they bend the cores on them too a little bit, but memory especially. I've never had better 3070s than the FTWs. Even Strix, they just don't touch them. So I think we'll end up with much higher clocks there, but I'm starting to see the memory is actually a little bit better on the card with the worst core. So we gotta keep an eye on that as I keep cranking the memory. But so far everything's handling 2800, and honestly, that's pretty good for a 3070. So none of them are D tier memory, none of them are C tier. We either have B or A. Oh, I spoke too soon. The Gigabyte was, the OC dumped off, and now it forgot the OC. I'm gonna have to restart. And there we go, device one. So this FTW3, not as good, but it took some serious memory clocking. It took 3100 to get that to happen. So this one's happy with 3000, and I could keep going with this card. We're at 3100, still stable, fluctuating between 116 and 117 watts. So the XC3 doesn't have quite the same memory bin, but the core is definitely really good on that too. Pretty happy with that. I have graded those. Now let's hop over to Flux and take a look at the cores. Yeah, that's pretty conclusive. The Gigabyte's actually starting to claw back a little bit here, just in brute force, but it's still the least efficient of the bunch. Followed by this FTW3. Followed by the FTW, followed by the XC, actually, according to the miner. I think that was right. That FTW and that XC flip-flop. Never mind. Okay, the FTW3. This card is still the best, followed by that, followed by that, followed by that. So there you go. That's kind of the basic process. I do like to do a core algorithm and a memory algorithm. I don't want to do Ravencoin, for instance, because it works both, and it's actually really, really hard to tell which one is good and bad when you're working both sides of the card at once. So that's kind of the gist of how I get that done. And the main reason I do it is mainly just for where I put certain rigs. Like I try to keep the most efficient cards here at home where my power costs the most. And then if I have a fringe approach that needs a 3070, I'd be like, oh, no problem. I've got a 3070 for you. And you can sell off a card that's still just fine for gaming, performs really well, but just isn't quite as power efficient. So hopefully that makes sense. I don't know if it's worth it to you or not, but to me, this is something I definitely like spending time on. It's actually kind of fun. And yeah, it just gives you a much better vision of what the cards will take for overclocks when you kind of group them together, how efficient they'll be, and which ones you're better off, you know, selling when the opportunity presents itself. So that's my basic guide to how I bin cards. Maybe it'll work for you, maybe it won't, but at least that's kind of how they operate.